Ashok joined. Yeah. Now, in a last class, we are discussing on the IP protocol. According to the IP protocol, first we started with the header format of an IT protocol. We discussed each and every field there. Then we started with a fragmentation of an IP protocol. Why a fragmentation is needed based on a MTU, maximum transaction unit, is different from one network to another network, and different size of packets will be moving from one network to another network. So how to convert the packet size where it will be MTU is less than the coming packet size. In that particular stage, how the things will be done by IP protocol, and then IP protocol will use the fragmentation technique. That is, it will make a parts of that original means a packet, and later on using a ident field identification will be given for that fragmentation flags, means unique identification will be given. Later on, the flag where bits will be in that, one bit will be taken for a fragmentation, it will be made as one, and offset values will be set from first part to the last part. First part will start from zero, the second part will start from the left out byte number, and third, so second byte last, after last, whatever sequence is there, it will start like that. So finally, the last fragmented part, there the flag value will be zero, which will indicates that there the this is the last part, but the identity field will be there and offset value will be there for that. So in this way, the fragmentation will be done, and reassembling will be done based on this offset values and flag values. Now this is a one particular problem which will be solved by the, or a service which will be given by the IP. The next service is, as we have discussed, that main important service is identifying a particular device or in a system in an internet world, or in a world which is connected with a unique identification. It will be done with an IP address, that is Internet Protocol Logical Address, where it will be of 32 bit and 4 bytes, which will be divided with a dot. So that we have taken into the consideration, and there will be three types of main classes will be there: class A and a class B and a class C. The IP address is divided into two parts. The starting part will be a network identification, and the second part will be a host identification. So in a class A, the starting bit will be zero, and remaining 7 bits, 1 byte. In that, 1 byte will be of the network identification. In that, starting bit always it will be zero, and remaining 7 bits value of the different number of number identification will be there, where the host address will be of remaining 3 bytes. That is, many of the hosts can be accommodated in a class A. Coming to the class B, where it will start from 10 and 2 bytes will be for a network identification, and 2 bytes will be for a host identification. So in 2 bytes identification, as I told you, that it will be identified with a network starting with 10. That means always the bit number should start, when you convert to the binary, the starting bit must be 10. That is almost all 121 series onwards, it will start. Before 121, it will be a class A, if you consider that. Coming to the next thing, that is part 2, in a class B will be of 2 bytes. That is, maximum 1 byte value you can have according to hers is 0 to 255. So 255 into means 256. 0 to 255 means 256. 256 into 256 systems. Almost all 65,536 systems you can accommodate in class B. Like that you can calculate. Coming to the next, but in class A, if you get a doubt, class A, you can accommodate 256 into 256 into 256. That is, that many systems you can generate an IP address. But in a class B, maximum 65,000 500 and change or 600 change you can accommodate. Coming to the class C, where it will start from 110. So the 3 bits number and the 3 bytes will be there for on a network address. Only 1 byte will be there for on a host identification. That means only 1 byte means maximum 0 to 255 systems you can make in a C class. That many IP addresses you can generate. That is 256 maximum IP addresses you can generate in a class B, starting from 191, I think. Means 191 range, 191, 192 range you can generate on a IP addresses. So in this way, the different class of IP addresses you can generate. And another one concept we have discussed, that is a very important concept, that is subnetting. Why a subnetting is needed? For example, assume usually the ISP providers, internet service providers, whoever are there, this is in general also you must know as a computer professionalist. So the once ISP provider will go with any telecom departments or telecom companies, he will purchase a bandwidth of internet from him. That is, he is a class A. And ISP provider, like for a BMS IT, Convergent India, which is there, he is an ISP provider. So ISP provider, when it goes with that particular thing, he will have a 65,536 or some that many IP addresses. Assume in a BMS IT itself, there are 2,500 students are there. Like that, some 10 customers are there, means 10 into 2,500. So how many IP addresses will go off? Like within a 10 customers, everything will go, means some 20 customers are there, everything will go off. You can't manage like that. Then what to do? Then for this particular thing, the concept of a subnetting has been there. What do you mean by subnetting? Subnetting is like this. For a world, only one IP address of your router will be shown, where in a public internet, the packet will be sent there. And your router should identify the internal LANs, which has been within a class C, identification will be there. And each LAN will have its own subnet number, which will be given. So according to that subnet number, your router will forward the packet to that particular LAN. And there, once it comes to that particular subnet number, a mask will be removed and it will be taken. So how it can be done? For example, I will tell you how a subnet number will be generated. Assume that one LAN is having some 50 systems is there, just for a second, telling 50 to 100 systems is there. 192 or 191 series, they will start 191.10.0.1, assume. From there, it will start and 100 systems are accommodated in one particular LAN. So there, what they will do, they will generate a mask, subnet mask. What is a subnet mask? 255.255.255.0. Why? Because 256 systems only will be accommodated in a class C, and remaining whatever is there, 3 bytes, it will be of a network address. So it will be covered with 255, all ones, and only this will be 0. Now you do a AND operation with IP address and the subnet mask. How a AND operation will be done? A bitwise AND operation will be done. Convert the IP address to the binary and convert the subnet mask to the binary, and you put that, and one by one you keep on doing with AND operation. That is, one under one will be one, remaining all cases it will be zero. Once a series of zeros and ones will be generated, again you convert that to the decimal number as 4 bytes. Then automatically a subnet number will be generated. So that subnet number will be used for the identification of one particular LAN. So the router will have only a subnet numbers worth it. With that subnet number, if the IP address, whatever the destination IP address is there, it will take that destination IP address and mask, whatever it will apply that marks. then automatically one subnet number will be generated. Means the router will have a subnet numbers, and assume some 8 LANs of BMS IT is connected to router. In that 8 LANs, it will check, yes, this is a subnet number which is matching. It will send to that particular LAN. So once the LAN it has been sent, it will be broadcast to all the systems. Once it comes to the packet, will comes to all the systems, that system will check whether this packet belongs to me. It will take that. Otherwise, the packet will be discarded. In this way, the Ethernet subnetting will be done in that particular manner. Coming to the next concept of an IP services, I am doing this revision. Those who are not attended, try to follow that. Those who are not followed also, you try to understand. Any questions you can raise in between also. Then coming to the next concept of the IP addresses, where subnetting problems is there. What is the problem of a subnetting? That is, if one router is having a 16 LANs, maintaining a 16 LANs of a table with the subnet numbers will become a problem. That is, it needs a huge memory in a router to take that particular concept, maintaining of that particular table. So for maintaining of that particular table itself, some time will be taken. Because of that particular reason, they will go for an classless identification or classless things. That is CIDR, classless inter-domain routing will be taken into the consideration. And this today, we are using this concept of an identification of an subnetworks or an extended LANs. How these particular things will be worked? Assume. Now again, come back to our BMS IT example, where I have told you that assume 16 different LANs is there. Even MCA itself, two LANs is there, like that. And Wi-Fi LAN is one, and like that. CS department may have some two LANs like that. So different 16 LANs is there, assume. Hello? Don't left out anyone. Any problem is there, you can stop and you can ask me. Yeah, so if you take that concept into the consideration, what actually the problem, it needs a more memory. To solve that particular thing, we'll go according to the block wise. What do you mean by a block wise? Instead of going like a department in identifying an individual LAN, you shouldn't do like that. We'll go with a series of IP addresses. For example, entire BSN block, four departments is there, including a civil. All four departments will start from one IP address, 192.10.0.1, and will come with series to all the, means all 256 systems will make one particular group. That means in that, how many bits are same? How many bits are same? According to me, the starting 20 bits or 24 bits will be same. So once that 24 bits is same for every means that particular of a network, that 124 bits is same, then you can group that particular things. That is only if, for example, you take only 2 bytes. You take a 2 bytes. 2 bytes means 8 plus 8, 16 bits. 16 bits at least will be same when you make one particular block of IP addresses. That whatever 16 is coming with the gateway IP address, whatever will be there, that will be taken as in a server. That IP address slash 16 will be given. What is that slash 16? Slash 16 is a 16 bits common IP address group which will be blocked. So whenever router, what it will do, whenever a packet will comes with the slash 16 as in a prefix, it will see that 16 and it will send automatically to the BSN block. And there, applying that particular, means whatever 16 bits will be there, that's a common. So remaining 16 bits will be changed. Only that will be compared with the IP address, it will be taken to the particular system. So in this way, the classless working of the thing will be done. Later on, we had discussed the other protocol support for an IP protocol, that is ARP protocol. The ARP protocol is the one where it will compares the IP address, logical IP address, with an MAC address or a physical address. If it is matching, then the packet will be converted to the frame and it will be sent to that particular system. And coming to the next, DHCP. DHCP is the one where the dynamic host configuration protocol is there. What do you mean by this? As I told you that for an ISP provider, assigning an IP address for an internet dynamically at that particular login time. Why these things must be needed for that particular ISP provider? For example, assume that as I give an example of 2,500 members will be there in BMS IT. Assume that all will not use the internet at a time. Somebody will be there in a class, somebody will be absent, or somebody will do some other works. Assume only 600 students will be using at the time that particular system. Now, assigning only for 600 members is needed, not for 2,500 members who are all enrolled for the internet. Why? Because all students, every staff will be enrolled. Now, how you can do this? How means the username and a password will be given to the each and every person to authenticate either first is belongs to BMSIT or not. Once the evaluation or authorization has been done, a request will be sent to the DHCP relay. Once the request has been sent to the DHCP relay, in turn the DHCP relay will send a request to the DHCP server. There, the server, what it will do, it will have a pool of IP addresses. In that pool, pool means in a buffer, some IP addresses will be there. So it will take one IP address and it will assign to that particular person at that moment. Then the relay will take back that IP addresses and it will assign to you. Once you logged out, then automatically that IP address will be released and it will be put back to the pool. So in this way, it will be keep on working. So DHCP server will be keep on working. You can ask me the question like this. Assume, sir, you have told that 500 IP addresses are there in a pool. Assume all 500 are working. No one has left out. Means 500 IP addresses are actually allocated already. 501 fellow will come. Then it will tell network busy. Very simple concept. Then it will tell network busy. Login cannot be assigned to you. Once the person will remove that, means will log out, then automatically IP address gets free. Then it will be taken and it will be assigned to you. Same concept will be there in a mobile communication also. Frequency will be allocated according to like this only. I will tell you that later. Don't worry about that. So this is another service which has been given by the DHCP. Coming to the next one, that is ICMP. That is Internet Control Message Protocol. Wherever the problem will arise in a network with the IP protocol services, for example, finding an a route, link failure, destination is not working, destination is not responding, or in between some node has been shut down. So all these problems, taking the new route, intimating the new route to the source, you take a new route. All these control works are flow control. Assume the packets is coming very fast from a sender. Receiver is a very slow processor system where it can't take that packets. Then it has to intimate slow down, please. Is very slow processor. Then that type of messages, control messages, even a flow control and congestion control, everything messages will be given by that ICMP protocol. So this is another one protocol which will be used. The next service, the last service of an IP protocol, that is a routing, where this is very much important service of the IP protocol. How a routing will be done? First, you should know the routing concepts. What is a routing? Routing, first we'll take a unicast routing. Later on, we'll go for the other routings. First, what do you mean by that? Source, a single source is there and a destination is there. And a packet should transfer from this source to this particular destination. Now, here the how much far the source and destination are there. In between, how many hops the packet should pass. This is a question arises always. Always the routing will be done based on a number of hops. That is in between how many nodes are connected. Always our network is connected in a form of a peer-to-peer network. That is a system-to-system connections will be there. So in between, maybe routers, maybe other devices, don't worry about it. So maybe other networks also, but a node-to-node communication will be there. So how the routing should done from this source packet, which is sorry, which is forwarded from here to that particular node, means destination particular node, how it should be done. So which algorithm it should be used, how the table should be maintained, either only routers should maintain a table or in between any other systems should maintain a particular tables. Then how this particular routing will be done, means how a IP protocol will find a path from source to destination. Once the path has been found, then the packets will be transferred in that. So what are the techniques we are going to use, that we will discuss now. Now I am going to share the PPT. Start listening with that particular 1 minute. Yeah, now we have discussed all these things, not an issue. Now coming to the routing. Forwarding versus routing. First we'll see what is a forwarding and what is a routing. You may think like that just forwarding is a routing. No, routing is different and forwarding is different. What is a forwarding? Forwarding is just to select an output port based on destination address and routing the table. Process by which routing table is built. So two ways is there. What is the two ways? Forwarding is, it's a connectionless. How means based on a routing table, already routing table will be there in a router. Based on a routing table, which output port the packet should go, it will forward that in that particular packet. That's it. Means forward in that particular port. One example I'll tell you in a forwarding technique. Assume the router is having already a forward table in it. That means how many other routers are connected to which particular port, and to other LAN networks is connected to which particular port, that identification will be there. The packet will come with on a destination address and it will tell this is so and so destination address. So this, according to the routing table, assume that this destination address is connected with another router, maybe of port 2, something like that. It will send to the port 2. That's it. So this is forwarding. What is a routing? Process by which routing table is built. What do you mean by this? At that particular time, if this is the source and this is the destination, now source wants to send a packet to that particular destination. At that time, the routing table will be built from a source in between routers and in the other destination system. That is called as routing. You got a difference, I think. The routing table, which is there already, according to that, it will throw the packets based on a ports, that is forwarding. What is a routing? If source now wants to send a packet to the destination, then source will intimate, yeah, I want to send a packet to so-and-so, please build a table. Then for that particular sequence of only temporary, of that particular sequence of communication from source to destination, a table will be built. Now coming to the next, in depth we'll go what is a routing. Now assume this network has a graph. I think you have studied already ADA. I know, right? Yeah, you have studied. No, ADA you have studied? Hello? ADA you have studied?
No, no sir.
I think in next semester you are having ADA. In ADA, you are going to study this Dijkstra's algorithm, Prim's Kruskal algorithms to make a spanning tree and all. You are going to study where you can recall there. And now observe a network as in a graph, G. So this is a graph. And here I will show with a mouse pointer. Now A, B, C, D, whatever is there, assume that are nodes or a vertices of a graph which will represent the devices. And assume the whatever edges is there within a cast. This is a cast or weighted graph. So in this particular thing, it will represent a cost of moving from a packet from A to B, that is 3. Moving a packet from A to F, that will be 6. Now, the basic problem of routing is to find the lowest cost path between any two nodes, where the cost of the path equals the sum of the costs of all the edges that make up the path. Are you getting? Now, assume, for example, if I want to send a packet from A to D, how I can send a packet from A to D? There is a several paths you can take via B, C, D you can come, via A, F, E, and D you can come, or A, B, E, D you can come, or A, E, D you can come. You are seeing in general. Now, out of these paths, which is the shortest path? So that path will be taken into the consideration. That is A, E, D. Why? Because only cost is 1 plus 1, that is 2. Remaining all will be greater than, that is 6 plus 2 plus 1. It is around a 9 year, and then year 3 plus 1 plus 1. So this will be around 5 year, and year 3 plus 4 plus 9. So it will be 7, 9, almost all it will comes under 16. So the nearer lowest one will be this particular path. So the lowest path will be taken into consideration always. For this, how will you write an algorithm? So you are going to write an algorithm for this based with an simple concept, that is Distrust's algorithm, which you can take into the consideration. Now you see, for a simple network, we can calculate all shortest paths and load them into some non-volatile storage on each node. Either you can do it in two ways. So you calculate all the shortest paths from which node to which node. You are taking that particular node at that particular time. We will take a time. So what we will do, we'll apply a Floyd's algorithm for that. Warshall and a Floyd's algorithm is there. You will come to know that in when we are discussing with the algorithms, there a Floyd's algorithm is there. What is a Floyd's algorithm? Based on a cost matrix from one node to the another node, the shortest path you can find. So such a static means that will be stored from this node to this node, this much this node to this node, this much this, from this node, this much cost. So means via which node it has to move, it will be there. Such a static approach has several shortcomings. It does not deal with the node or link failure. Observe carefully. This is a problems which is there with that type of a static table formation. It does not deal with node or a link failures. It never goes with link failures there. Why? Because it's already ready-made. Once the topology systems has been connected, then each node will have a table. For me, how many are connected? For me, how many are connected? What is the distance? So like that, it will be there already, ready-made like that. So in this, link failures will not come to know. Means suddenly some link failure occurs, will never come to know. Does not consider the addition of new nodes or links. If new nodes is added, you can't have that. Why? Because it will be a static information which has been stored. Again, somebody has to reconfigure it. It implies the edge cost cannot change. So this is the problems. Now to solve these problems, means Floyd's will not help in that particular nature. Now, what is the solution? Need a distributed and a dynamic protocol. What do you mean by this? Needs a distributed and a dynamic protocol. So what is a distributed and a dynamic protocol? At that particular time, the source, the table will be constructed with all the nodes, whatever is there in that topology, starting from source to the destination. Two main classes of protocols will be there in that. One is a distance vector, which we have already discussed in a lab program. Everyone listening, in a lab program, we have already discussed one concept of routing algorithm is a distance vector. Observe that. How much very important the distance vector is there. Initially, each node will have its own table. its own table will be there initially. Then every quantum time, the exchange of tables will be done. Then automatically it will update the table according to that. And final table will be ready with all the nodes with the shortest path. This algorithm also I have told you. Then the link state algorithm is another one, routing protocol. This two routing protocols today is ruling this one means it's ruling the entire internet routing nowadays. Coming to the summary of this particular thing. So distance vector I have discussed already, am I right? So I have told you how this particular things will be worked. Coming to here, we have looked at this particular thing, different services, issues, everything. And we have discussed two major classes of routing protocols, that is distance vector and a link state protocol. With this particular thing, we'll go with the other concept of the, sorry, other concept of the part of an routing in depth we will go, and we'll discuss how that particular will be done in advanced internet routing. Now, for a sake, now I will stop this sharing. I'll close this. Yeah. Again, we'll go and we'll share the other one. Yeah. Come back here. Now, fourth chapter will start. Yeah. So, in a fourth chapter, we'll come to know this particular topics, that is global internet. Now you know the routing routing concept we know, then how a global internet will be there, means how a routing will be done in a global internet. Then multicast, then we'll come to know how a multicast, if number of sources are more, many, and number of destinations are more, so how packets will be sent. Other for example, single source to many destinations are many destinations will be there, single source, or different sources to one destination, or many sources to many destination. So like this. Then mobile IP. How in a mobile communications, the IP protocol will play the role, especially in a mobile internet. So this is the outline of this particular chapter. Sorry, here. 1 minute. Yeah, which we'll come to know that. Yeah, this chapter of four is called as Advanced Internet Working. The problems, how do we build a routing system that can handle hundreds of thousands of networks and billions of end nodes? So here, as I told you, that source to destination, simple concept I told. Then how a routing will be done in a different networks, heterogeneous networks from one network to another network, where plenty billions of nodes are there. How to handle address space execution of IPv4, how to enhance the functionalities of internet. So this is the outline, as I told. Then a chapter goal, understanding the scalability of routing in the internet. So how extension of routing can be done in a vast internet, discussing the IPv6 new version of an IP protocol, understanding the concept of multicasting, discussing the mobile IP. Now we'll come to the global internet. So this is, as you have seen today, the world, the tree structure of the internet in 1990s, keep in your mind. Today, still it has become a very vast here. So NSFNet backbone is there here. So this is one type of a network. It's not an ARPANET, it's a NSFNet. What do you mean by NSFNet? The network will be there in a hierarchical format. Almost all it will be there in a hierarchical format. So how the net has been divided into the different regions, you can see how it has been different regions. It has been bar net, west net, mid net, how it has been divided. And you can see after dividing that, how the different, with that region, how the different sub-states, it has been divided in America. So you can see same concept in India also. Whenever a network is there, that network, how it has been divided into the regions. That is North India, South India, East India, West India. So Northwest India, Northeast India, like that. region which has been divided. There, under the region, different states will be there according to our country. I'm going to tell. So states will be there, and each states will be identified again with a. So this is a tree concept of again a global internet. So entire world today, I will tell you one thing. Entire world internet, according to the things, it has been divided into. It has been divided in 1990s. In that range, it has been divided into two parts. Now it is three parts. Now it has been divided into the two parts. One is west area and east area. Entire east countries, whatever is there, east continent, Asian continent, and whatever east countries is there. There, in a Singapore, a server is there, which is called as an Apache server, which will support the entire internet of eastern countries. And in a west side, there is one server which is there, which will support name of the server is there. I've forgotten that. So I'll tell you that. So that particular server is there, which will support all the western countries. So like this, it has been divided into the world. Coming from that particular part, assume now we'll come to the Apache server. Now Apache server is there. Now that entire Asian countries will be there with that particular thing. Now from there, these two servers, means this western country server and this eastern country server, which has been connected with each other. Now this whatever connection means is there here, countries whatever is there, from there it will come VSNL, our India, for example, Videsh Sanchar Nigam Limited. So that particular organization of an India will be connected to that particular server. From Videsh Sanchar Nigam Limited, it will be distributed via other telecommunication companies to all the other ISP providers. From there, ISP providers, it will come to the individual persons as an internet. So that things you must keep in your mind. Coming to the next thing. Any doubt you can raise in between also, not an issue. Now, backbone server provider. Now you can see how I can tell. Large corporation is there here. Consumer ISP is there here. Observe here. Consumer ISP is there here. Backbone service provider. What do you mean by this large corporations? As I told you that large corporations is like this. The telecommunication providers, means internet providers, whoever is there. Backbone service provider, one person will be there. Always, as you can see with the large corporations. What is this backbone service provider? Assume Videsh Sanchar Nigam Limited, maybe BSNL, like that. Yeah, background processor will be there. From them, it will comes to the peer points. So assume you're a peer point. There, consumer ISP provider will be there. So consumer ISP provider, from him, it will comes to the small corporations. What do you mean by small corporations? Different companies like BMS, IT, like that, it will comes. And it will comes over there. Like this, the distribution will be done. Now, observing this particular concept, so how a routing should be done? Imagine here, how a routing should be done. For example, I'll tell you like this. A large amount of internet should come to the consumer ISP provider. Why? Because he is having a customers more here. So from here to here, how internet will flow? How, what large internet will flow? Assume he is having like this small corporations, some 100 corporations is there. So 100 corporations of data, everything, whatever internet data should be maintained by him. So he has to maintain that. And he is a customer to this corporation. Means assume how he should maintain that body. Yeah, one real-time example I will tell you. When we gone to the Cisco, for your seniors, we visited a Cisco company. There we have seen in a room racks together routers which will be there. Assume that like your library, means where racks will be there, and in a racks like books, routers will be there, and everywhere cables. That cables, we asked what is this cables, they told that it's an optical fibers of one gigabits, more than that, one pentabits cables also they have shown. and it has been connected with the routers where large amount of data will come and go. Assume that one entire big room is having these racks and each racks is having a routers. Now imagine, then I asked this much data from where this much traffic is coming and where this much traffic is going. They told like that for us as a Cisco, for us the customers are Airtel and the other companies are there where a large 85% of their processing will be done in a Cisco. Now imagine, that is, assume the Airtel traffic. How many customers of Airtel will be there? Assume now for a sake, I'll tell you, in India, how many Airtel customers are there? In that particular time, how many persons are using net and how many persons are using a data calls? How many persons are using video calls? How many persons are communicating? So with a voice channels, how to process this networks? How to make a links? So this entire concept will be done by Cisco. Cisco is a network-based company, you know everything, I think. So that's a large company. So because of, to maintain, as you imagine, that now you can imagine the traffic of that Airtel. So how that particular thing? Now like that, two customers are there, assume for a sake, I'll tell you, Airtel and Idea is there for a Cisco. If for two customers, how much traffic will be there? How to maintain that traffic? Then how many routers is needed? So how the routing should be done in that particular concept, in a vast concept, you have to think always. Coming to the next concept, that is inter-domain routing. What do you mean by this inter-domain routing? So if you take this inter-domain routing, we'll call it as an BGP. What is this BGP? Border Gateway Path. So border gateway path, what you will take in that, we are going to take AS, autonomous systems. That is, internet is organized as autonomous systems, each of which is under the control of a single administrative entity. For example, BMS IT is one particular AS. VTU is one particular AS. Like this, for example, one company, you can say Indian Bank. Indian Bank is one particular company which will be there as one particular EAS. Like that, we'll consider a different company, organizations, backbone networks as an EAS. So how the BGP protocol will work, we'll discuss in a next classes. And with that, how EGP will work, Extension Gateway Protocol. So border gateway protocol, extension gateway protocol, I'll tell you how these two things will, these two protocols will be help in a routing, how the routing will be done from one AS to another AS or within a AS and group of AS to another group of AS, how a communication will be done. We'll discuss in a next class tomorrow. The class will be, just I'll stop the show. So tomorrow, the class will start at 10:50 again, same timing. The class will be there and we'll go with that particular class. Thursday, right. So we'll have a look on a VMware. Today we'll send that particular software. You install today and tomorrow you install. From Thursday, we'll start another one lab program there. Before going to lab program, lot of the things is there, means to discuss about TCL scriptings, how a TCL scripting should be done, what are the important things in a TCL scripting, how a small programs you can do in that TCL scripting. Afterwards, we'll go with the this one. So here afterwards, that TCL scripting classes, I will take Monday. Monday theory class is not there, lab is there, no? So in that afternoon, lab hours, 2 hours or maximum 1 hour, I think. One and a half hour I'll take this session. Why? Because it's somewhat large, explaining on a TCL. So coming from next Monday, we'll start next Monday. Coming from next Monday, in a lab hours afternoon at 2 o'clock to 3:30 or a 4 o'clock, I will teach you the NS2 programs, starting with TCL scripts. We'll learn first, and later on we will go with the lab programs. There is some 9 hours teaching thing is there, or different small programs you have to do, and later on we can go. That is another 1 week or 2 weeks is needed for that. So afterwards we can do the lab programs of a part B. First duty of you is to install the VMware which I'll send today. And that how to install VMware and how to go with that, I will tell you in tomorrow's class or Thursday's class. I will tell you. First, you collect that software and keep in your laptops. Then I will tell you. Okay. Thank. Any doubts first is there? It's open for discussion. Any doubts is there? Come on. Any doubts is there? Gudiya?
No, sir.
Gudiya is there in class? Hello?
Hello?
Gudiya, any doubts?
No, sir.
If any doubts is there, personally also you can call ma, not any issues. Okay? And you can ask sir. Me how that particular concept I didn't understand, sir. I'll repeat that. Not on issues. Okay.
Okay,
thank you very much for attending this particular class.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.